Before we move into the calculations, let's have a look at another term which is related to energy-based calculations, that is known as resilience of the material. The resilience of the material is its ability to absorb energy when it is deformed within the elastic limits. So when you unload the material, this energy will be returned back by the material. There are two quantities which are related to this property of material. The first quantity is known as modulus of resilience. The modulus of resilience is a strain energy density term, which is the area below the stress strain curve up to the yield strength of the material. So since we are defining resilience up to the elastic limit, since sigma y is the elastic limit, the strain energy density corresponding to the yield strength of the material, that is the area below the stress strain curve up to yield strength, is termed as modulus of resilience. So it is given as U capital Y equal to sigma y square divided by 2e. Another term related to resilience is known as proof resilience. So this is the total strain energy content of the body. So the modulus of resilience multiplied by the volume of body would give you proof resilience of a particular component. So the proof resilience is for a particular component, whereas modulus of resilience is related to a particular material. So these are the two terms which sometimes you come across during the energy calculations. So you should be aware of this. Let's have a look at two examples which illustrates the use of the equations that we have developed. Let's say we want to calculate what is the strain energy content in a rod of length L and cross-sectional area A and subjected to load P. For solving, the solution is given here. So let's see how this solution is obtained. So here we know that the strain energy density, or small u, for the body is given as sigma 1 square divided by 2e. Now the strain energy content of this rod will be given as u multiplied by volume of this particular rod. So that will be sigma 1 square divided by 2e multiplied by volume of this particular body is nothing but a multiplied by length, area multiplied by length. If you write the sigma 1 square in terms of the load and area, you will get it as P is the load, area is the A. So this whole square divided by 2E multiplied by A into L. Rather, this is capital L. So if you simplify this, you will get P square multiplied by L. One of the A terms will get cancelled with the square term, and you will have 2AE. So this is the term that is what is there for the rod. So for a rod which is subjected to axial tension, the strain energy content is given by the expression which is given there. Now let's have a look at a problem which is that of a stepped bar. So instead of a bar of uniform cross section, let's consider bar which is having stepped cross section. In the second problem, we are having a stepped bar. It is having two different cross sections. The smaller cross section is having area as A, and the larger cross section is having area N square times A. The length of both the cross sections, or both the sections, is L by 2 and L by 2. And the modulus of elasticity of their entire body is given as capital E. And you want to know the total energy content, strain energy content of this body. So let's do the calculations. So I'm just quickly redraw the case. So we are having a composite bar having both section lengths as L by 2 and L by 2. The smaller one is having area A, and the larger one is having area N square into A. Let's call the smaller cross section 1 and larger cross section 2. The total energy content, strain energy content of this body will be given as the summation of energy content of part 1 and the strain energy content of part 2. So the total strain energy content would be given as U1, that is strain energy of part 1, and U2, that of part 2. Now let's use the basic equations what we developed previously. So we'll get here U1, which will be given as the axial stress in first part divided by 2E multiplied by volume of first part plus the axial stress in second part divided by 2E multiplied by volume of second part. Now let's put the values of the equation into the field. So this body is subjected to a load P. So we can write the sigma 1 and sigma 2 in terms of the P. So we'll get the sigma 1 square as P divided by A the whole square divided by 2E multiplied by its area and its length, which is L by 2, plus for the second body we will get P divided by N square A, so that is the stress, the whole square divided by 2E into the volume of the second body, that is its area multiplied by L by 2. So if you simplify this particular expression, we will get it as the first expression will become P square L divided by 4AE, and the second expression would become P square L divided by 4N square AE. So taking the common terms out, we'll get the total energy content as P square L divided by 4AE in the bracket 1 plus 1 by N square. So this is the total energy content of a composite bar. So in this way, we can calculate the energy content of a body having a different cross sections. Again, here we are considering the actually loaded parts. If the cross sectional areas are varying, then this approach we'll have to do by integration. So we'll have to add individual strain energies in elemental sections and then integrate over that to get the total strain energy content. We can also cross-check our solution by putting n equal to 1. So if n is equal to 1, in that case, it becomes a rod of uniform cross-section. So we should get the expression which we got earlier. So if you put n equal to 1, so for n equal to 1, we will get U as P square L divided by 4AE multiplied by this expression becomes 2. So we'll have 2AE. If you check at the previous slide, you will find the same expression we have got. Till now, our discussion was focused on bodies which are subjected to axial loading or the bodies which are under normal stress. The same idea can be extended to bodies which are subjected to shear loading. So we'll see that next. So similar to the bodies which are subjected to axial loading, if the body is subjected to shear loading, and if you plot shear stress versus shear strain graph, which is shown in the figure to the left side, in the exactly same manner as that of the actually loaded part, the strain energy density for shear loaded component is given as the area below the shear stress versus shear strain curve. So if the body is strained up to a level gamma xy, and at that level the shear stress is tau xy, the strain energy density would be given as tau xy multiplied by d gamma xy and integrated from 0 to gamma xy. So for body which is having an uniform shear stress, this particular expression could be written as 0 to gamma xy. The tau xy we can write as g times gamma xy times d gamma xy. So this will give us the value as g times gamma xy the whole square by 2. And if you substitute where g is the modulus of rigidity, so g equal to tau xy divided by gamma xy. So by substituting the instead of gamma xy, we can write in terms of the shear stress. So in which case we will get the value of u as tau xy square divided by 2g, which is similar to the expression which we got for the axially loaded component. If you want to calculate the total strain energy content, we can obtain it by integrating over the entire volume or multiplying the strain energy density by the volume of the body if the body is having uniform cross section. So the expressions are almost similar. You substitute sigma by tau and epsilon by gamma, you will get the expressions for the shear loaded components. We can use these expressions to calculate the strain energy content in a bodies which are in pure shear. So the most common example in mechanical engineering will be a shaft subjected to torsion. So it is a pure shear stress distribution, and we can calculate using this expression what is the energy content in a shaft which is subjected to torsion. So let's see that next. So let's consider a case of a shaft subjected to torsional loading. So I'm considering a shaft of length L and subjected to torque T. And let's say the radius of this particular shaft is given as capital R. By using the expression for strain energy density, we know that the strain energy density is given as tau xy the whole square divided by 2g. By using the torsion formula, we know that the expression for the shear stress is by the classical torsion formula tau xy by r equal to t by j, where j is the polar moment of inertia of the cross section. So this implies tau xy is t r divided by j. So here r I'm calling about the shear stress at a point which is at a distance r from the center. So the tau xy varies from, it is zero at the center and it becomes higher. So we are considering a local point where the shear stress is tau xy and the location is at distance r from the center. So by substituting in this particular expression, we get at that particular point, so the point which we are considering, so at this point the strain energy density would be given as the TR by J whole square divided by 2G, which would be given as T square by J square multiplied by 2G into R square. Now since we want to calculate the total strain energy, so total strain energy will be given as the strain energy density integrated over the entire volume. So here the strain energy density has a particular location at distance r from the center of the shaft. In order to do this calculation, we have to integrate this over the entire volume of the shaft. So we can write this expression as integration. What I'm doing is the volume integration I'm splitting into two integrals, one over the length of the shaft, because this distribution of the stress doesn't vary across the length of the shaft. So the length of the shaft varying from 0 to L, and second is the area at a particular distance. So I will get it as T square J square 2G into R square dA, where the dA is any local area at a particular cross section from a body. So this will get you t square j square multiplied by 2g multiplied by the integration. Okay, here so we have the over the length also will require. So volume I'm splitting as dA into dL. So the integral 0 to L dL multiplied by integral r square dA over the total area of cross section. So we this particular integral is nothing but L. So we'll get t square L divided by 2 j square g. And this particular integral is nothing but the polar moment of inertia. So this is nothing but j. So this multiplied by j. So we get the expression for the total strain energy content of a shaft which is subjected to torsional loading as t square L divided by 2 j g. So this is how we will calculate the strain energy content of a body which is subjected to shear stress. So here we are taking an example of a shaft subjected to torsion. The expression for the strain energy is what we just now derived is for bar under torsion is given by this particular expression. In the discussion till now, we have considered the bodies which are either under axial loading or under the torsional loading. But the same idea can be extended further to a body which is subjected to a general state of stress. So we will see that next. So when a body is subjected to a general state of stress, that is at any point you are having a stress state given by the stress tensor having it six unique components. So at that point, the strain energy density can be given by the expression which is given here. So this is nothing but the addition of the strain energy term arriving from individual normal and shear strain component. So for example, if you consider sigma x component, we know that because of sigma x, the strain energy density would be given as sigma x square divided by 2e. The same expression can be written as sigma x by 2 multiplied by sigma x by e. And sigma x by e is nothing but the strain epsilon x. So it is half sigma x into epsilon x. So because of the normal stress in x direction, the strain energy density would be given as half sigma x into epsilon x. Similarly, so if you look at this term, you have the half term which is taken out from all the terms. So first term is sigma x into epsilon x. The next term is sigma y into epsilon y and so on. So we are having all the six terms which give us the total strain energy content of the body. So remember that this is a strain energy density and not the strain energy content of that body. So at a particular location, a particular particle of that body will have strain energy per unit volume, which will be given by this particular expression. If you want to calculate the total strain energy content of the entire body, you will have to integrate this expression over the entire volume. And that way you can obtain for any general case the strain energy content. So typically for complex shapes where the stress distribution as well as the geometry is complicated, these values are obtained by numerical methods, and it is used quite extensively in finite element methods.